It may seem that the young mother has not yet mastered childcare rules very well. The clothes she has chosen are too warm for home. But the woman knows very well what she is doing. It is a cage kit in which she will put her baby. All over the city, all over the country, thousands of women leave their babies in lattice cages. While the babies are suspended dangerously high above the ground, their mothers quietly cook dinner or dress up. Even the president's wife happens to be among them. Now there are mobile apps that immediately translate your speech into another language. But did you know that a similar device deciphers babies' cries? With 92 to 98% accuracy, the app will tell you why a baby is whimpering, from hunger, pain, fatigue, or a wet nappy. What do you think of the white noise generator? It turns out it's hard for babies to fall asleep in silence. When they're in the womb, they hear a continuous, monotonous hum, like a washing machine or a hairdryer. This is the sound of blood and lymph moving in the mother's body. So, clever and enterprising people have created a white noise generator that mimics the sound the baby is used to. Modern technology can make life as easy as possible for parents with a small child. It is possible to use a sleeping mat, a bodysuit, socks, or wristbands to read all possible information about the baby. On their smartphone, parents can find out body temperature, heart rate, blood oxygen levels, and even track their baby's movements. Walking and traveling long distances with your baby is no longer a problem. You can easily fold the pram into the baby carrier. The world's smallest stroller weighs just 4 kilograms and has made it into the Guinness Book of World Records. But not so long ago, the same pram was a luxury only royalty could afford. If you think we're getting off topic, we're not. Prams have everything to do with why mothers locked their children in cages. The first mobile device for walking with your children was a miniature carriage designed by architect William Kent in 1733. He received a special commission from the Duke of Devonshire, who struggled to cope with his 6 young offspring. The prototype buggy had to be harnessed to a pony, but that wasn't a problem for the wealthy Duke. Devices for a trivial stroll with children remained an advantage to the aristocracy until the mid-1800s. The real revolution came from Queen Victoria, who, in 1840, took her children for a personal walk in the Royal Park. She used a revamped pram to do it. From the outside, it looked like a carriage harnessed by Her Majesty herself. The unstable, tall structure had to be dragged along, but no one promised it would be easy being a mother. Since then, all the world's nobility has had such carriages. However, such a process of walking proved too grueling for society's ladies, so nannies started to carry the prams with them. In fact, the poor women replaced the ponies in the first version of the harness. Unhappy nannies had to moonlight as heavy hitters until Charles Burton built a prototype of the modern buggy. He equipped it with a handle to be pushed rather than dragged. The wheels swiveled individually, making the pram more maneuverable and easier to steer. The infant basket became double-sided so that nannies and parents could keep an eye on the children. In 1889, a breakthrough came when American William Richardson took out a patent for a modern pram. However, the manufacturers didn't think of any safety precautions, which resulted in many injuries to the little ones. It wasn't until the 1920s that the design became safer, with better brakes and straps, reinforced frames, and bigger wheels. Gradually, pushchairs ceased to be a luxury. They became increasingly affordable, just like cars. As baby strollers had wheels, they were equated with vehicles. Nannies were required to have a license when they were hired. Women with prams and cars traveled on the same road and were considered equal road users. Because of this, prams were even turned into mini cars. However, even before the car era, young parents were faced with a dilemma. On the one hand, well-known pediatrician Luther Emmett Holt, in his book, The Care and Feeding of Children, argued for the need to ventilate the child. On the other hand, there were too few parks and places to walk with children in industrial cities. Many houses didn't even have a small courtyard, and the dirty air and road noise discouraged people from leaving the flat altogether. Holt's work was enormously popular. The doctor described the benefits in detail and gave specific instructions. To toughen children up, he recommended exposure to cool air and water. It was believed that this would strengthen their immunity, which could easily resist colds. In addition, fresh air is involved in blood renewal and purification, which in turn has a direct impact on the growth and development of the baby. Airing improves the baby's digestion and positively affects the baby's well-being. No woman would disregard this advice from a medical authority. Regular airing has become part of every new mother's routine. Holt has thought of everything, so he has left readers with the most explicit possible guidance. Airing is worthwhile in almost any weather. In warm weather, the baby can be left a meter away from the window, but only from 7 o'clock in the morning until sunset. In winter, and during the colder parts of spring and autumn, it is advisable to choose the time between 10 to 11 a.m. and 3 p.m. Only be sure to prepare your baby for airing beforehand. The first few times, you should limit your baby to 15 minutes a day, adding 10 minutes every day. When the wind is blustery or the snow is melting outside, it is worth limiting the time outdoors. Children under 4 months of age should not be ventilated at 0 degrees Celsius. And for babies younger than that, the maximum threshold is -7 degrees Celsius. There seem to be no more detail or completeness to the scheme, but many young moms only ever want the best for their babies. The instructions were soon refined by Eleanor Roosevelt, wife of the then future US president. After her daughter Anna was born, the 21-year-old mother bought a wired cage for birds. Then she hung it in the window of her New York flat and put a wicker basket with the baby in it. This happened in 1906. The decision seemed logical. The baby gets as much air as possible and gets all the benefits of fresh air. Plus, the woman acted on the doctor's recommendations. At the beginning of the 20th century, fresh air was thought to be the leading way to fight tuberculosis. At that time, they even started building open-air schools to stop the tuberculosis epidemic. But the Roosevelts' neighbor wasn't medically savvy. When he saw a crying baby suspended in a cage, he threatened Eleanor that he would report her to the authorities. Later, when Roosevelt became president, the woman made the excuse that she knew nothing about caring for children and, of course, did not want to harm her daughter. She adhered to medical advice and sought to provide the infant with fresh air. Although Eleanor was criticized, her act later inspired the creation of baby cages. In 1922, an enterprising woman named Emma Reed decided to patent the portable baby carriage. The device had to be hung out of a window so that the child could breathe fresh air. It was a sort of improvised mini balcony. The reasoning for the invention in the patent documents was somewhat unorthodox. The woman envisioned that infants could be removed from the crowded urban environment in this way. And while such an idea may seem strange now, in the 1920s, it was well received. Cities around the world were sprawling, and little thought was given to the need for baby walks in the process of building new homes. Mothers used every available means to ensure their children got their fresh air. When people in 1930s London found out about baby cages, there was no shortage of excitement. Babies of different ages began to appear over the city's streets everywhere. Cages were particularly popular in densely populated areas, where parks and spacious yards were a thing of the past. Over time, it wasn't just young mothers who started using the American invention. Such cages began to be provided in urban communities. For example, the Chelsea Baby Club gave them to every family in a house without a garden. By 1935, cage balconies had been provided in new middle-class developments. The Royal Institute of British Architects did the design. Of course, this was not widespread. Many parents were conservative enough to treat their children like birds. When World War II came to London, baby cages disappeared due to constant German air raids. Babies increasingly spent time in bomb shelters. It seemed that the story of a strange invention was over, but in 1953, the British Pathé News Service produced a spot about a valuable and practical gadget for young parents. After the war, baby cages made a comeback in British homes. Why was it so popular? Because cages were cleverly designed. Firstly, the cage had a removable roof to protect the baby from rain or debris drops, such as bird droppings, leaves, or bricks. Secondly, they were securely fastened. If you look out of the window, you can probably see hundreds of air conditioning units hanging over the heads of passerbys, but firmly fixed to the wall. The cells were fixed on a similar principle, and this eloquent fact evidences the degree of effectiveness. Amazingly, no injuries or fatalities have ever been reported in the many years the cages have been in use worldwide. The same cannot be said for the first prams, which cost many babies their health. The cages, on the other hand, guaranteed the baby's safety. Nevertheless, baby cages began to disappear from the facades of homes gradually. In the late 50s, their sales began a severe decline, and eventually the product disappeared from the shelves. With the increase in traffic, they lost their essence of providing clean air for children. On top of this, child protection legislation became stricter, and babies behind metal bars became simply intimidating. Do you think baby cages are an exciting and practical device, or are they just a weird idea? Share your views in the comments section, and do not forget to like the video if you liked it, and subscribe to our channel.